In this lecture, we're going to study how the operating system communicates with several types of input-output devices. So what are I/O devices? I/O devices are things like the disk, keyboard, mouse, the network card, a gaming console, anything other than the CPU and memory that connects to your system, right? So these I/O devices connect to the CPU and the memory via a bus, right? There are different types of buses. So you have the memory bus that connects the CPU and the memory, right? So this is very important. And there are several other layers of buses through which I/O devices can connect to the CPU and memory. So there are high-speed buses like the PCI bus, or there are slower buses like the SCSI, SATA, USB, and so on. And different I/O devices connect through different types of buses to the CPU and the memory. And this point of connection where a device plugs in to the system is called a port, right? So an I/O device connects via a bus to a port on the machine. So while there's a lot of complexity in the different types of I/O devices, let's try and establish some basic terminology that is common across a set of I/O devices. So devices are of two types. You can either have what are called block devices or character devices. So block devices basically expose a set of numbered blocks, say block numbers 1 to a million on some device. For example, a disk exposes a set of blocks on a storage medium. On the other hand, character devices simply produce or consume a stream of bytes. For example, the keyboard simply gives you all the bytes that are typed in. A network card gives you all the packets that come in through the network card. There's no notion of saying, give me the block that came yesterday, right? It simply gives you a stream that is coming right now, right? So you have block devices and character devices. And across all devices, all these types of devices, they expose an interface consisting of some memory registers to the operating system, to the CPU and memory. And so what is this interface? What are the registers? There is a status register that basically tells you the status of the device. Is the device busy? Is the device doing something? Was there an error? And so on. And there's a register in which you can give the command that the device should execute. For example, you can tell the disk, read this block, write this block, and so on. And finally, you can put some data that you want to transfer to the device in the data registers. For example, if you're writing a disk block, you can give the data to be written in this data register. And if the disk is reading a block, it will put the data that it has read into this data register, right? So these are roughly the three types of registers that are exposed by the device to higher layers. And internally, the device has a lot of complexity. There could be a microcontroller, a small CPU doing some of the work of the device. There could be actual hardware, there could be some memory, all of that. The internals of the device are usually hidden from the operating system. So the only thing the operating system does is communicate with the device through these registers in the interface. So how does the operating system read and write to these registers? There are two different ways in which to do it. One is there are explicit instructions provided by the underlying hardware. For example, on x86, you have the in instruction and the out instruction, which can be used to write specific values into the register. For example, you can write a certain command to read a disk block into a certain disk register, into the command register of the disk, right? Using these instructions. So these are, of course, privileged instructions, which can only be accessed by the operating system. So if a user program wants to read to a disk, it'll have to make a system call. It'll have to make the read system call, and the operating system will do the job of actually issuing these instructions and writing to the device registers. The program does not have to worry about all of this. So explicit instructions is one way. The other way is what is called memory mapped I/O. That is, all of these registers simply appear like memory locations, and you simply read and write memory locations. Like you would assign a variable x equal to 4, you would assign some value to some register, and the underlying memory hardware will realize, oh, these memory locations are not actually actual DRAM or something, but these are registers in the device. So when requests to these memory locations come, the memory hardware will either direct them to the actual RAM or it will direct them to a device like a disk or something else, depending on what the addresses are. So certain part of the memory address space is reserved for IO devices, and the CPU can simply read and write to devices just like it is part of the memory. So that's just more convenient, though both ways, either explicit instructions or memory mapped IO, are equivalent. So given that we have the ability to read and write to these device registers, what does a simple execution of an IO request look like? So suppose you want to read or write a disk block from a disk. What do you do? The first step is the operating system will check, is the device busy? And if it's busy, of course, you cannot talk to it now, so you wait. And once the device is free, so this is this part. You wait for the device to be free, then whatever data that you want to give to the device, you give it. For example, if you want to write a disk block, you give the contents of the block to the device. And then you issue a command to the device. You tell the device, hey, write this block for me. You write the command. And then you wait for the device to finish the operation. After the device finishes the operation, it will set some status bit saying, hey, I'm done. I could finish writing your block. And this is when an IO request is complete. Right? So this is a simple way in which you can communicate with an IO device. So in this protocol, there are a few things that are not exactly right and are not super efficient. And this is not how real devices work today. So I'm going to point them out. Right? So the first thing is, there's this lot of waiting in this busy while loop. There is polling, right? So if this is what a CPU does in order to write to a disk block, is wasting a lot of CPU cycles, because the disk takes a lot of time to satisfy every request. And for all that time, if the CPU is simply spinning in a while loop, it's really not efficient. You might as well go and run some other process in this time, right? So the simple protocol here has polling, right? For example, this while loop here, which is not very efficient. And the next part that is not very efficient is, there's a lot of work involved in copying data, right? This is also called programmed IO, because the CPU is actually, the CPU program is actually doing the IO. So that is this step here, okay? So anytime you want to read or write data from the device, in this simple protocol, the CPU is actually involved in manually copying the data from the main memory into this device register, right? So this takes a lot of time and this wastes a lot of CPU cycles, again on a very simple task. So this is, while this is a reasonable model for a simple device, for a simple IO request, there are these two inefficiencies in this model, and I'm going to describe modern techniques that fix these inefficiencies. So the first thing is, of course, the concept of interrupts, right? So we've seen interrupts in the timer interrupt before. So what is an interrupt? An interrupt is a way for a device to tell you that, hey, I have some news for you, right? So when the CPU gives a request, for example, the CPU is running process 1 here, and process 1 issued an IO request that you want to run on the disk. So while the disk is processing that IO request, the earlier model we've seen, the CPU is constantly polling. It's constantly waiting. Are you done? 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 Instead of that, what the operating system can do is, it can put this process 1 to sleep, right? This process 1 goes to sleep and another process 2 starts running on the CPU, okay? And this process executes on the CPU for this duration, and during this time, the disk is actually involved in completing the IO request of process 1. Now, once the disk finishes, the disk can raise an interrupt. Right, it can tell the CPU, hey, you asked me to write this block for process 1, I did it and I'm done. Or you asked me to read this block for process 1 and I've read the block, here it is. The disk can interrupt the CPU, at which point the CPU can decide, okay, fine, process 1 can execute now, it is ready to run now, and it can get back to process 1. Right, so in this intermediate duration, the CPU can go back, do some useful work of running some other process, right? So this is the interrupt-driven model of IO. And this is what happens in almost all modern operating systems, right? So anytime a device raises an interrupt, the process switches to kernel mode and you look up an interrupt descriptor table, right? There's a table containing all the routines that you have to run. If the disk interrupts, here is the function to run. If the network card interrupts, here is the function to run, right? And different devices raise interrupts with different numbers. There is a what is called an IRQ number associated with each device, so that when the device raises an interrupt, you know, okay, this is the disk. So let me run this function to handle the disk interrupt. And as part of this interrupt handling routine, the kernel will make note of the notification of the device. It'll pass on this, say the data that the device is giving to whichever process wants it. It'll unblock any processes that are waiting for IO. It might start the next IO request if there's a queue of requests pending. Once the device is done with one, the OS can decide to give it the next request and so on, right? So all of this work is done once the device says, I'm done with the job and raises an interrupt. Okay? So instead of busily polling for a certain IO task to get done, the CPU can switch to doing something else, and when the device completes, it can handle the interrupt. Okay, so of course, interrupt driven IO comes with its costs because you have to shift to kernel mode, you have to context switch to another process, you have to come back to this process again. So overall, if your device is going to take a small amount of time, then it might just be okay to just poll and wait for the thing to get done rather than context switching to another process. So in most cases, interrupts are a good idea, though there might be still a small number of use cases left for the idea of polling. So the other source of inefficiency that we've seen in the simple design was the CPU copying data to and from the device. So for example, the CPU is running process one here, and process one does a write, wants to write something to the disk. Then the CPU spends a lot of time copying data from main memory to the device register, copy, block by block or byte by byte. It spends some time copying data and then it gives the command to the disk. The disk starts off and here the process has switched to another mode, right? This is the part where it is not polling. But so you don't have the polling overhead, right? Here it is doing the right thing, it is running another process. But here you still are wasting CPU cycles copying data. So even this part can be optimized. Right, almost all modern IO devices can use a feature called direct memory access or DMA. So there's a special piece of hardware called the DMA engine. You tell the DMA engine, hey, copy this information from this part of memory into this device. You tell the DMA engine to do that and it'll do the job for you, right? So here the CPU, instead of wasting time writing to the device, it'll context switch, it'll run some other process. But before doing that, it'll tell the DMA engine, hey, here is the block of data I want to write to the disk, please copy it to the disk. It'll give that instruction to the DMA engine and it'll go off, do something else like running another process. And then the DMA engine will finish this copying and then the command to the disk is issued to write the block, right? So the CPU is saving on two types of work. It is saving on the polling overhead, where it is not waiting for the device to complete, and it is also saving on the memory copy overhead, where it is not wasting CPU cycles copying data from the main memory to the device memory or vice versa. So even in the case of a read, right? So the DMA engine will first copy the received data from the device to main memory and then an interrupt is raised so that the CPU does not have to worry about copying the data when it is called in, when it is executed, right? So these two ideas of interrupts and DMA save significant amounts of CPU cycles. So finally, the part of the OS code that does all of this talking to a device, giving commands, handling interrupts, just basically babysitting that device, that part of the OS code is called the device driver. So for every device, you will have a specific piece of OS code, a separate device driver that understands the language of that device. It knows what are the names of the registers, where is the command register located, where is the status register located, and so on, right? The device driver speaks the language of the device and it is used to communicate with the device. So most of the OS code is written at a higher layer, right? So the operating system code is written saying, okay, let's send this block to the device. Let's get this block from the device. It's written at a higher layer. For example, file systems, reading and writing files, the operating system simply deals with blocks. It says, write this block of device to the disk, read that block of device, and so on. There is a generic block layer. Okay? And the specifics of actually how do you read a block, how do you write a block, what do you talk to the device, that is handled by the device driver layer. The rest, the application, the operating system code, the file system, the generic block layer, all of this do not have to worry about the device specific details, and the device specific details are handled by the device drivers.